Dear students, Assalamu alaikum. I am Mathila Khatak, teaching English. This lecture is a continuation of the earlier lectures about the kinds, cases and uses of a pronoun. So our objectives are the same as we had said in the previous lectures. Let us move to the fourth kind of demonstrative, a fourth kind of pronoun, which is called demonstrative pronoun. Demonstrate, as is clear from the name of this kind, demonstrate means to show something, to point out something, to indicate to something. So that something we are showing, we are pointing to, or we are indicating, maybe close to us or far away from us, with respect to its position and distance or time. When we say with respect to its position and time or distance, it means the thing or the noun that we point to, we indicate to, are showing may be close to us or far away from us. With respect to its distance or with respect to time. So let us see the definition. This type of pronoun is used to indicate, point to some person, object, thing, animal, idea or quality in a sentence. So in short words, we can say they point out nouns, they indicate to nouns, or they show nouns, because are the these are, and this is included in the definition of a noun. Object, thing, animal, idea or quality, they are included in the definition of noun. So they often distinguish their targets, distinguish, separates, make it quite different from the other. Whenever they point out something, whenever they indicate to something, that thing is separated completely from the other by pointing or some other indication of position. So the particular noun referred to by using demonstrative pronoun can be either near or far in distance or time. Specifically, the particular noun referred to, so I am talking about the same thing as we discussed here, the particular noun referred to by using demonstrative pronoun, whenever they are used to refer to something, can be either near or far in distance. It can be close to us or it can be far away from us with respect to its distance or time. So demonstrative pronoun list can be seen over here. This, that, these, those, such, they are called demonstrative pronouns. So this is the whole category of demonstrative pronoun. How are they used? For example, we say this is the book that I want, that I need. So this one is demonstrative pronoun. Why do we call this one as demonstrative pronoun? Because this one indicates to the book within this sentence, within this group of words. So demonstrative pronoun will usually refer to the thing in the same sentence within that group of word. So this is the book, this refers to this book that I need. That here is not demonstrative pronoun. We will discuss it as we go on. That is here a relative pronoun, because it has a relation with this book. It is defining this book. So we cannot call it over here as demonstrative pronoun. It is another kind. The same form, but different function, and because of their different function, we call it not demonstrative pronoun but a relative pronoun. We will discuss it in the last slide, I think. So this is the book, this refers to this book. So it has been specified, separated, pointed out, it has been shown. This is why we call it this is the book. Let us see how is it far away from us or close to us. This is the book. This is used when the thing is close to you, when the thing is singular and close to you. So this is the book, it is close to you and it is singular. If the book had been far away from us, and then you would say, that book, that is the book that I needed. That is the book that I needed. So the next example, those. When the thing is far away, when you refer to something far away in time or distance, you use those or that. So those were intelligent people who discovered penicillin. Those were, it means these people, you are referring to these people who are far away from you with respect to time. In time they are far away from you, that's why you use those. You, if they had been close to you in time, you would use these, or intelligent people who discovered penicillin. But now you can see they are far away from you, back in time, that's why you are using those were intelligent people who discovered penicillin. So these are delicious mangoes. It means these mangoes are close to you and they are plural in number. When they are plural in number and close to you, you use these. If they are singular in number and close to you, you use this. If they are many in number, plural in number, and far away from you in time or distance, you use those and that. So the next kind, as you can see, is indefinite pronoun. Indefinite is very much like a common noun. They are very much like common noun. Indefinite means the thing is not specified, nothing special is referred to, it is not specified, or and we do not talk about exact things. We talk about things using these pronoun in general. So the indefinite pronoun is used to talk about something which is not specific. The thing is not specific. It refers to non-specific beings, objects, or places. Indefinite pronouns can also function as other parts of speech too, depending on the context. As other parts of speech too, depending on the context, means they can be used. Indefinite pronoun can be used with nouns, and then they are called indefinite adjectives. In that case, we do not call them indefinite pronoun, then they become adjectives. So we will discuss it later. Indefinite pronoun list, you can see many, another, anybody, anyone, anything, all, none, no one, everybody, everyone, everything, they are indefinite pronoun. Why do we call them indefinite pronoun? Because they do not refer to anything specific. They do not talk about things which are specified. So let us see the examples. I don't want anyone to see it. I don't want anyone is indefinite. Anything is indefinite. Everything is indefinite. All, much, no one. No one can be replaced with none. N-O-N-E. No one is equal to none. So I don't want anyone to see it. So you are not talking about any special person. You do not say that I don't want Ali to see it. You are talking about people or persons in general. That's why we call it indefinite pronoun. Is there anything in that box? So if you specified this thing, you would say, is there the book in that box? Is there the pen in that box? So you are talking about things in general. All were invited to the party. You do not say that Raza and Hamid and Rana, they were invited to the party. So you are using this to refer to things in general. If you are using it to refer to things in general, we call it indefinite pronoun. Much has happened since we met. Much, it doesn't refer to anything particular, so it is indefinite pronoun. No one can cope with her in English. Cope with, compete with her in English. So you do not say you cannot cope with her in English. So if you had been used over here, it would mean you have specified the person, but here you are not specifying that person you are talking about. That's why we call it indefinite pronoun. The next kind at the chart of indifferent ground, you can see over here. So here you can see the chart of indefinite pronouns, and they are either treated as singular pronoun or plural pronoun, or both singular or plural pronoun. So what does it mean, singular pronoun? They are purely treated as singular pronoun. Singular pronoun in the sense that they are followed by a singular helping verb or a main verb. A singular helping verb means if they are followed by a singular helping verb, it must be as, was, or has. As, was, or has. If they are followed by a main verb, it must receive SRES. For example, very much like those singular noun, for you say Ali takes exercise in the morning. You cannot say Ali take exercise in the morning. So Ali takes exercise. Ali is a good boy. You cannot say Ali are a good boy. Very much like that case of singular noun and plural noun. And here we can also see them as singular, plural, or both treated as singular and plural. For example, you say another period or in progress is wrong. You will say another period is in progress, or another project is in progress. You cannot say another project or in progress. So another is treated as a singular pronoun. Another example, you can see enough. For example, the remaining will be left for you to do for practice, and you will send the images to me. So for example, we say enough has been said about democracy and Pakistan. You cannot say that enough or said about democracy in Pakistan. So enough is treated as a singular pronoun. You cannot treat it as a plural pronoun. As a plural pronoun would mean enough or said, or is wrong to use with enough. Very much like another project, as is correct or is wrong. So enough has been said. You cannot say enough have been said. Enough is treated as a singular pronoun. Similarly, let us see nothing. For example, you say nothing has changed in this government. You cannot say nothing have changed in this government. So you are treating nothing as a singular pronoun, not as a plural pronoun. As a plural pronoun would mean that, for example, let us repeat this one. Nothing has changed in this government. You cannot say nothing have changed. If you are using have, it means you are treating as a plural pronoun. So this group of pronoun, they are purely treated as a singular pronoun. Plural pronoun, for example, you say both are free to go. Both are free to go. You cannot say both is free to go. As is wrong to use with both. Both are free to go. You cannot say, I am repeating, both is free to go. And for example, you are using many. Many have tried. You cannot say many has tried. Many have tried their hands at this project. So many is treated as a plural pronoun, not as a singular pronoun. Many have tried their hands at this project. So both you use them both as singular or plural. They may be used both as singular or plural pronoun. For example, you say all is well that ends well. All is well that ends well. And you can also use it as a plural. You can also treat it as a plural pronoun. For example, you say all were invited to the party. So it can be used both as a plural, and it can be treated both as a singular or a plural pronoun. All is well that ends well. And you say In the first sentence, it is treated as a singular pronoun. In the second sentence, all were invited to the party, it is treated as a plural pronoun. So, for example, you say, in this case, some are born great. Some are born great. Kuch log azim paida hote hain. Wo pehle hi se azim hote hain. So, some are born great. And you, in this case, you are treating it as a plural pronoun. Some are born great. In another example, in the second example, you, for example, say, some knows the right way to success. So you are using some knows. You do not say some know the right way to success. You are saying some knows the right way to success. So some is treated both as a singular pronoun and as a plural pronoun. The next category of pronoun is interrogative pronouns. Interrogative pronouns are so called because they are used to ask question. An interrogative pronoun is used in a question. The words within this category are who, which, where, how, and what. So you can see how are you now. How is used before helping verb, and it is putting a question, it is asking a question. That's why you call it interrogative pronoun. Interrogative pronoun, I'm repeating it once again. Interrogative pronoun are used to ask a question. They can also be used as interrogative adjective, and we will see it in that lecture of with regarding adjective. But here you can see it is used as an interrogative pronoun. Why is it called interrogative pronoun? Because it is used before helping verb. How are you now? So how it comes before helping verb, which it comes before helping verb, what it comes before helping verb, it clearly shows that they are interrogative pronouns. So interrogative pronouns are used to put question, how are you now, which is your favorite book, which is your favorite book, what is your full name. The next kind of pronoun, intensive, they are called intensive or emphatic pronoun. As I had told you in the earlier lectures that we differentiate between reflexive and emphatic pronoun. They have the same form, but they have different position in a sentence. So let us see the difference in the use of intensive or emphatic pronouns and reflexive pronoun. The definition goes as under. The intensive or emphatic pronouns is used as a reference to another pronoun or noun in the same sentence is a way of emphasizing it. Both reflexive and emphatic pronouns have the same forms. They have the same forms, but they occupy different position in a sentence. For example, the dog caught the ball itself. The dog caught the ball itself. Now this itself can be used over here. The dog can be used, but it is not fixed to be used here, but it can be used here. The dog itself caught the ball. Sarah cooks dinner herself. Sarah herself cooks the dinner. I eat myself my candy. So emphatic or intensive pronoun are used to emphasize the doer of the action. The doer of this action caught is the dog itself. Sarah, the doer of this action, herself. I, the doer of this action, eat myself. So it can be used immediately after the subject. The subject, the dog, Sarah, I, they can be placed off immediately after the subject. But in the case of reflexive pronoun, they are used toward the end of the sentence. Toward the end of the sentence, for example, let us see them. Reflexive pronoun will end in self or selves and is used in reference to another pronoun. They also make a reference to the same person in the sentence. In English, reflexive noun are used when a person or thing acts on itself. For example, see the sentence's structure, which is quite different. He takes care of himself. Another thing you need to note over here, that you cannot drop this himself, this you, herself or yourself. But in the case of emphatic pronoun or intensive pronoun, you can drop them and the meaning of the sentence is not disturbed. In this case, if you drop these reflexive pronoun, the whole structure of the sentence goes down. The meaning is disturbed. You cannot get any sense out of it. He takes care of. Take care of, you need to say something. So himself, herself, yourself, they cannot be dropped. She can do it by herself. So these reflexive pronoun are following preposition of, by, you could travel by yourself. For example, we say he was talking to himself. So himself cannot be he was talking to. You cannot say he was talking to himself, to me, to his brother, yourself. He was talking to himself. So the action goes back to the doer, to the subject. Here we do not emphasize, we do not intensify, we do not give importance to the doer of an action. We reflect back the action to the subject, to the doer who is responsible for it. So we say he takes care of himself, by herself, you, by yourself. In the case of reflective pronoun, intensive or emphatic pronoun, you say the dog caught the ball itself. So itself can be dropped. The meaning is not disturbed. The structure of the sentence will not be affected. You can, for example, say the dog caught the ball. So the meaning is complete. Itself is not that integral part. It is only used for emphasizing the doer of the action, which is the dog. The dog itself, it can be placed, as I told you here, the dog itself caught the ball. Sarah cooks dinner. You can say, if you are using a preposition over here, it would mean you are turning it into a reflexive noun. Sarah cooks dinner by herself. I eat my candy by myself. By myself, by herself means she was the only one. I was the only one. I was all alone. I was lonely in this action. She was lonely in this action. The dog caught the ball by itself. The dog was quite alone in that action. So they are quite different from each other, and they can be dropped. Reflexive pronoun cannot be dropped. They are used for emphasis. Reflexive pronoun refer back to the doer of the action. Reflexive pronoun are preceded by. Preceded by means, as you just noticed, they are preceded by what? They are preceded by preposition. Prepositions come before them. And reflective pronoun, they are not preceded by any such preposition. So the next kind is reciprocal pronoun. Reciprocal pronoun is used to show an action or feeling which is reciprocated. Words in this category are one another and each other. There are only two reciprocal pronoun. Reciprocated means one act upon the other. One act upon the other means both act on each other or one another. Each other is used when there are two persons. One another is used when there are more than two persons. For example, they are happy with each other. It means these are only two people. They are happy with each other. And they are written as, you can see, each other separately, one another separately, not as one word. The two friends really care about one another, not the two friends. This should be the three friends. It should be the three friends. the three friends really care about one another. If the number is more than 2, you use one another, they are happy with, it means they are 2 in number. So when each one of them acts upon the other, that's why we call them reciprocated. Reciprocated means act one upon the other. The next kind is, as you can see, relative pronoun. So relative pronoun simply means to relate or refer to things already mentioned in a sentence. By using relative pronouns, we mean to give some extra information about the thing already mentioned in that sentence. Relative pronouns are used to introduce, you can say, another clause. They introduce another clause which is related to the earlier clause very closely. So let us see the definition. This type of pronoun can be used as a way of giving additional information within a sentence. So they are used to give additional information within a sentence. A relative pronoun is a pronoun that relates to the word that it modifies. It modifies another word already mentioned in that sentence. They refer back to people or things previously mentioned, and they are used in relative clauses. So all of these are relative clauses which you can see after these bold words. These are relative pronouns, and these are relative pronouns, and the part of sentence after these relative pronouns, it is and they are relative clauses, and they are also called dependent clauses, and they are also called subordinate clauses. They are called relative clauses because they are closely related to the earlier part of the sentence. Let us see the example. The list: who, whom, which, whose, and that. As I told you about that in the same lecture, that can be used as a relative pronoun, it can be used as a demonstrative pronoun, and the situation is quite different when you differentiate between them. So the woman who, so the woman is the already mentioned part. Who called yesterday wants to buy the house. So who is here a relative pronoun, and this whole is a relative clause, dependent clause, adjective clause. They are given different names with respect to their function. Now they were driving by the house. The houses is all the already mentioned part of this sentence, which Andy had described. The houses which Andy had described. She is in her test, whose work I really admire. So in her test is, and we get further information about this artist, in our test about her being in our test. The author whom you criticized in your review has written a letter in reply. The author, this is the already mentioned part, and we get extra information by using relative pronoun about this author. This is my brother who lives in Karak. So this is my brother. My brother gets extra information. We get extra information about my brother who lives in Karak. This is the bike. So we get extra information about this bike, which is that my son likes the most. This is the bike. The bike that my son likes the most. So we get extra information about this already mentioned part of the sentence. That way, why we call it relative pronoun. So the definition is quite clear now. Relative pronoun gives you extra information about the earlier mentioned part of the sentence. The next category of pronoun, you can see, we call them distributive pronouns. Why are they called distributive? Because they refer to each and everything separately. It divides each and everything. Each and everything is separately referred to. They are divided. They become quite individual things when they are referred by distributive pronouns. So each, either, and neither are called distributive pronouns because they refer to persons or things one at a time. Note that a distributive pronoun is always singular, and as such it should be followed by a singular verb and a singular noun and a verb. Let us see what is described here. Let us see in the example. Each new day is different. You cannot say each new days, so it is followed by a singular noun and a singular helping verb. You cannot say each new days are different. It should be ईच न्यू डे इज डिफरेंट, ईच न्यू डेज इज रॉन्ग और इज रॉन्ग. सो ईच ईदर गर्ल कैन डू दैट. यू कैन नॉट से ईदर ईदर गर्ल्स. ईदर कैन बी प्रोनाउंस्ड एज आइदर. सो ईदर और आइदर गर्ल कैन नॉट गर्ल्स गर्ल कैन डू दैट कैन डू दैट. नीदर और नाइदर आंसर इज करेक्ट. यू कैन नॉट से नाइदर आंसर्स आर करेक्ट. It will be wrong. Each of, neither of, and either of are followed by plural nouns and singular verbs. The verb is still singular, but the noun become plural. So each of the answers. You cannot say each of the answer. Answer will be wrong in this case. Answers is correct in this case. So each of the answers is correct. You cannot say each of the answer is correct. Neither of the girls can do that. You cannot say. It will be wrong to say either of the girl can do that. It is wrong. So either and neither should be used only in speaking of two person or things. When more than two person or things are spoken of, if you are talking about more than two persons, in that case any, none or none should be used. It means if you are talking about two things, you can use either. For example, either girl can do that. It means there are only two girls. If you are using for more than two girls, in that case you need to use none of the three girls. You cannot say either of the two girls will be wrong. In that case, if the number is more than two, you need to use none of the three girls can do that. It will be wrong to say neither of the three girls can do that. So either and neither is used only when you are talking about two person, and if the number is more than two, you need to use any, no one or none should be used, as I had already discussed it in the chart of indefinite pronoun. So I think you got all the important points. Do ask me, forward your question to me if you have any question in your mind. Thank you very much.